Well, good morning, everyone. My name is Isaiah Peertz, and this is Total Sovereign Grace Ministries. The title of our message today is Two Vessels, Two Examples, Two Destinies. So this is the three twos, the three twos. So turn with me to Romans chapter 9, verse 11 and upwards. And this is based on a Bible study I recently did in my house, and I thought that this message would be best presented to you. So turn with me to Romans chapter 9, verse 11. For the children being not yet born, neither having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth. It was said unto her, the elder shall serve the younger. As it is written, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. What shall we say then? Is there unrighteousness with God? God forbid, for he saith to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. So then, it is not of him that willeth, nor of him that runneth, but of God that sheweth mercy. For the scripture saith unto Pharaoh, even for this same purpose have I raised thee up, that I might shew my power in thee, and that my name might be declared throughout all the earth. Therefore hath he mercy on whom he will have mercy, and whom he will he hardeneth. Thou wilt say then unto me, why doth he yet find fault? For who hath resisted his will? Nay, but O man, who art thou that repliest against God? Shall the thing formed say to him that formed it, why hast thou made me thus? Hath not the potter power over the clay of the same lump, to make one vessel unto honor, and another unto dishonor? So here we see this example of God's sovereignty. We see this example of two vessels. This is a vessel of honor and a vessel of dishonor that is created by the same person, the same being, if you will. And then they have two different destinies. They have two different purposes. And this example is also given to us in the example of Esau and Jacob. Esau and Jacob, neither of them were born yet. Neither of them had done any good or evil. So that eliminates works from the equation. God didn't look down time and see Jacob as better because it said that it was not of works. It was the divine purpose of God's election, that the purpose of his election might stand. So we see here Esau and Jacob, two of the same, but God chose one. God didn't have to choose either. God could have chosen both, but God chose one, because it was the good pleasure of his will, as we can see all throughout the scriptures, especially in Ephesians 1. But another example of this vessel of dishonor that we see is brought up in verse 17. It says, for the scripture saith unto Pharaoh, even for this same purpose have I raised thee up, that I might shew my power in thee, and that my name might be declared throughout all the earth. So God gives us this example of another vessel of dishonor, not just by using Esau, but by saying Pharaoh was a vessel of dishonor, and that God used Pharaoh for a purpose that his power would be made known, and that he displayed his power by crushing and destroying the Egyptians and destroying Pharaoh and eventually establishing the kingdom of Israel. All of this was part of his divine plan. This was not God looking down time and seeing how he was going to react to certain human interactions. This was God ordaining it. This was God ordaining it. Yes, Pharaoh sinned. Yes, Pharaoh consciously made these decisions. Yes, Esau sinned. Yes, Esau made these decisions consciously. But God, in his sovereignty, chose to allow them to die in their sins. And God chose to use them to display his power. As God chose Jacob, he allowed Esau to die in his sins. And just as God did the same with Pharaoh. Neither of these two merited any favor of God, Esau and Jacob. Neither of them had done any good or evil because they were yet to be born. But we see it's that purpose of God according to election, not according to man's will. So we see these two vessels here, Esau and Jacob. One is a vessel of honor, one is a vessel of dishonor. But we see that God is using this as an analogy of all humans, that there are vessels of honor and vessels of dishonor. There is no vessels of neutrality, no vessels of just, I don't know. There is either a vessel of honor or a vessel of dishonor, and you and I are one or the other. As a matter of fact, we see another example of this throughout the scriptures. We look at John chapter 2, and we see that vessels are mentioned again in John chapter 2 of Christ transforming dirty water into the best wine. We see that. So we see that it is an act of Christ turning this dirty water in these stone pots, these stone vessels, and he transforms this dirty water into perfect, good, the best wine, as the governor of the feast said. You've saved the good wine for last. So we see that. And we see the same thing in salvation, that Christ changes a dirty, filthy human and transforms them into the likeness of himself. A new creature, a new spirit. So turn with me to John chapter 2 and we'll read that. And the third day there was a marriage in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there, and both Jesus was called and his disciples to the marriage. And when they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus saith unto him, they have no wine. Jesus saith unto her, woman, what have I to do with thee? Mine hour is not yet come. His mother saith unto the servants, whatsoever he saith unto you, do it. And there were set there 6 water pots of stone, after the manner of the purifying of the Jews, containing 2 or 3 firkins apiece. Jesus saith unto them, fill the water pots with water, and they filled them up to the brim. And he saith unto them, draw out now, and bear unto the governor of the feast, and they bear it. And when the ruler of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine, and knew not whence it was, but the servants which drew the water knew, the governor of the feast called the bridegroom, and saith unto him, every man at the beginning doth set forth good wine. And when men have well drunk, then that which is worse. But thou hast kept the good wine until now. This beginning of miracles did Jesus in Cana of Galilee, and manifested forth his glory, and his disciples believed on him. So a lot of us, and me for the majority of my life, the vast majority, really up until not too long ago, we looked at this miracle, and I looked at this miracle and said, wow, well, this is just Jesus turning water into wine. But no, there is a spiritual meaning behind it. Everything Jesus does, everything Jesus says, has a spiritual meaning. Yes, he physically did this. Yes, he physically did all of the things that the Bible says he physically did, but there is a spiritual meaning behind it. He takes this water in this vessel, and he totally transforms it into something of utility. He transforms it into something of purpose, of something of goodness. And that's what Christ does here. He held all the power to do that. The power did not rest in the vessel. The power did not rest in the filthy water. The power rested solely in Christ Jesus. And we see in Romans 9 that the potter makes one to honor and another to dishonor. It is all in the power of the potter's hands, and that potter is Christ Jesus. So we see this 2 examples of pots or vessels, and we see that in both examples, God is given the absolute glory, and God is given the absolute sovereignty, and God is given the absolute ability to do as he pleases. God is shown to display his total sovereignty. Sovereignty, sovereign, reigns over all. And we see that. And we see just as he ordains many and saves many, there are people ordained such as Pharaoh, such as Esau, who will not be saved. As a matter of fact, turn with me to Jude chapter 1. Jude chapter 1. And here Jude is writing. He says in verse 3 of chapter 1, beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that ye should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. And then he goes on to say, for there are certain men crept in unawares, who were before of old ordained to this condemnation. Ungodly men turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness, and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. So we see here, all throughout the scripture, it's not Old Testament, it's not just some pieces in the New Testament, you can find it everywhere, that there are people who have been ordained to certain destinies. There's 2 vessels, 2 examples, 2 destinies. And Jude writes about it here. So we've seen all that God is in control. Yes, do the people who are ordained to condemnation, do they sin and do this on their own? Absolutely. All of us are guilty of sin. But it is the divine grace and mercy that is displayed to some that redeems them. It is not that as if man just needs a chance and these guys don't get chances. They just They're just destined to this, and there's nothing they can do about it. No, it is that this is their sin. They love living in their sin. They don't want to leave their sin. They want to stay in their sin, and God does not give mercy to them. And some want to stay in their sin, but guess what? God takes that grip upon them and transforms them, just as Christ did to that dirty water in those vessels. He transformed it into wine. He makes vessels of honor and vessels of dishonor. So the question for you today is, which are you? Are you a vessel of honor or are you a vessel of dishonor? What is your destiny? This burning desire should be in all of us to follow Christ, to be a vessel of honor so that we can run the good race. We can finish the good fight. And we can have the Lord Jesus Christ say, "Well done, my faithful servant." This should be the goal of all believers. We cannot be vessels of apathy. We cannot be vessels of indifference. Uninvolved, we can't be these lukewarm vessels. You are either a vessel of honor or a vessel of dishonor. There is no in between. There is no third destiny for people who are just not quite on one side or the other. He who is not with me is against me. And that is from Jesus Christ himself. So what is it for you today? Are you a vessel of honor or are you a vessel of dishonor? We ask the Lord to bless the reading of his word today. Thank you and God bless you.